Let us start this lecture with a thought process from Mahatma Gandhi. He says, a country remains poor in wealth, both materially and also intellectually, if it does not develop handicrafts and its industries. So, we know that Mahatma Gandhi, who was an ardent supporter of the making cloth using the hand, therefore, we are having a legacy of cotton making by ourselves. Let us recall what we had learned in the last lecture. In the last lecture, we looked at the question why we need to have cotton industries, particularly in handlooms, which is having the historical base. Then we looked at the evidences in literature, starting from Ramayana and Arthashastras and other things. And also we looked at that the cloth making was there even in the during Indus Valley civilization. Later on, we also looked at what are the side effects or the drawbacks of modern cloths and the unnatural dyeing being used in the modern cloths, and which is causing detrimental effects not only on the health but on the water and also air to some extent, and so also the soil is getting contaminated. Later on, we moved into the also the various aspects of cloth making in India, and each state is having their own design of fabrics and also the kinds of looms they are having. Today, we will be looking at basic processes involved in cotton making or you can say textile making. If you look at handloom textile technology, is consists of three things. One is making of the fiber, right? How to make the fiber from the main ingredients, for example, cotton or maybe silk or maybe linen or the jute, like how you will make the fiber. Then question is how you will weave it, weaving, you know, weaving of the cloth to the fabric in the loom structure, and of course, you will have to use the dyes to have better color and attraction for that. And these three components we will be discussing. We will start with the fiber and how to make fiber from this. Let us look at the basic processes involved during textile making in ancient India, and even today that is true, but in ancient India people are doing all the thing by hands, and they were using certain simple technologies for that. If you look at like a spinning of the cotton, jute or linen or silk fiber, various kinds is the first important things. That is basically will be coming from the raw materials. And then of course, the you can color or the dye it fibers, or you can color it after making of fabrics. And these fibers will be converted into yarns. And this yarns means thread, basically yarn means nothing but thread. Weaving of this yarn will give you the fabric or the cloth. And this dyeing, it can be done printing on the fabric itself, and also you can, as I told earlier, dye the fiber or the dye the yarn itself, so that you can get a various design, make a various combination of colors and design kind of things. And if you look at like the, as I told earlier, that in India the design was like various kinds even in a single state. That means if you go to each region will be having their own design and own even like various kinds of looms they were having, and as a result the creativity was intact due to the weaving and designing of the thing. And if you look at various tools being used for weaving the cloth manually, and some of the tools I will show you, and this if you look at this is a kind of a spindle, and this we call it as a drop spindle, and in Hindi it is known as taklis. There are various kinds you can get in country, but the basic principle remains same, that it will be moving around and the yarn will be produced from the cotton. There is also a very old this kind of instrument, which is known as basically some arrow kind of things, which we will be discussing a little later on. This is very old in this our country, and you might have seen in your local areas, and even still it is being used, and this is used for carding the cotton, which will be cleaning and also the making it fiber separated out. And there is a hand tool which is being used, which I will show you how you can use this tool, the hand carding tool, this one I am mentioning, right, which can be used to make a kind of a punis of the cotton. And there is another one which is a roller carding tools, and which is a little recent one you can think of, but again you can use a hand to carding that. Of course, you will be knowing it is a very famous, and then kind of charkha we call, or a wheel, spinning wheel, and this is the another form of this charkha, that is a tabletop spinning wheel. And this is of course a loom, which is a traditional loom by hand, and which we will be discussing some of this design, but some of the designs are not being used today, and it is going out of our culture, and because of power loom. And this is known as sattal, and which will be carrying the bobbins of the threads or the yarns, like threads, and which will be moving or it will be part of the weaving process, and which we will be discussing later on. So, what I would like to suggest, that you just keep these tools in your mind, so that it will be helpful as you go along to understand this about their functions and then how it is being used. So, how to make a fiber cotton? If you look at the, we will have to basically start with the cotton, which you will get from the, by cultivation from the plant, and you will have to collect it. Collection is very important, and it will be containing the seeds, these cotton seeds, and these seeds has to be separated, and that we call it as a ginning. Ginning is basically a mechanical separating process, in which cotton fiber will be separated from the seeds, and it will be baled. Baled means a stack of cotton together in a particular shape, what you can think of. And then you will have to do this carding. Carding is a process by which the cotton lint is cleaned and straightened out, and that we call it as carding. And of course, the last process, what we call, is the sliver making, and it is basically process of making a thin strand known as sliver, and you can call it also as a cotton punis or the rolls. And this will be the shape one can use basically from this rock cotton from the plant. You will be getting, making this cotton punis, which will be used for making yarns. So, therefore, this process has to be done, and let me just tell you that the cotton seed can also be utilized for making oils, and which can be used for various purposes. It is important that this has to be separated and also can be utilized. That is the reason why it is very important to be separated properly and collected. So, let us look at the story of cotton to fiber, basically how to convert the cotton to fiber. I will show you a video which is available in the YouTube. You can see that also, but let us look at how it is being made. Let us see how the cotton can be converted into a fiber with the help of this video, which I have taken from the YouTube. I am really grateful to this old lady who has really demonstrated this work, and you can see that she is now making a punis, and this punis she has made from the carding, using that carding tool by the hand. And this punis, of course, from India, and this punis she has made. Now she is showing you that how to make the yarn from this punis using a drop spindle. And let us see that how the takli or the drop spindle work in more detail. And this video,
here is the machine gun of the non-violence movement in India and the key to independence. It is known as Sakri, a substitute for the spinning wheel for those who are moving about and are unable to devote the time required for the spinning wheel. It costs but 1 cent and can be conveniently carried about so that each spare moment while talking with friends or traveling or listening to lectures can be devoted to spinning. Here is my cotton for spinning yarn. Cotton is grown, clean and supplied in India by Indian labor. Spinning is very easy and can be learned by anyone, even a child, in a few days. If a man works at Takli during his spare moment, about 4 hours per day, he will be able to spin 400 yards of yarn, which is sufficient to supply his own clothing, consisting of his cap, his shirt, and his dhoti. He spends an extra hour a day on spinning. He will be able to supply yarn for those who are unable to spin and thus eliminate the purchasing of foreign cloth.
So let us look at the basics of cotton textile. And as I told earlier, this is basically the raw cotton, and we'll have to utilize this cotton to make the punis, and from punis we'll be making the yarn. The question arises, what do you mean by yarn? Yarn is basically a long continuous length of interlocked fiber used for weaving and knitting or knitting. And you can, simple term, you can say it is a thread, right? That you will have to make by twisting it so that it will be having a more strength. The standard measure for length of cotton yarn is basically hank, and one hank is 767 meter. That is the unit what is being used. And there are two types of yarn is used. One is hank yarn, which is basically used for handloom production and which will be looking like that. This is basically the hank yarn. The other one is the cone yarn, which is used for the mill productions, like in the mechanized one, this is basically cone yarn. And the process of converting cotton fiber to yarn is quite complex. And that's why we were using the taklis, which is a very simple one, and charkha is also being used. And the fibers are to be separated first and then assembled into loose strand, is basically known as carding. And carding tool is very old in this country. According to the historian Joseph Needham, bow instrument was used for carding, which is also known as kaman. Kaman means bow in Hindi, and dhunki. So this is being sewn here, the kaman and dhunki, which is being used for carding. And this has been tied over here with the string, and then you can use this for carding purposes. You might have seen, and even like I think last year I saw in my native place, and for what you call cleaning the cotton, old cotton, whenever we make a mattress, we'll have to clean and then make this, loosen this cotton, and this is still being used. And that is from where? When it was 200 AD. So 1800 years still we are using. That is the technology we are still having, and it is a good one, and which is used for loosening the texture of the fiber by vibrating string. The string has to be vibrate, this has to be vibrate here, and then you can make that thing easier, and it will be hanged from the top so that you can utilize very easily. Of course, the strength and fineness of yarn is generally dependent on the staple length of the fiber and skill of the spinner. So you need a very good hand to do that, because it will be twisted. so that it can take the strength or the thing. As I told earlier, that yarn can be produced in two ways. One is by hand, and which was being used basically in our country earlier days, even today also. But of course, nowadays machine is being used, that is the mechanical process, converting the cotton to sliver and then spun by hand in various thicknesses. That is also can be, is being used today in our country, even in handloom sectors. And meal sector, it is a machine which will be doing, and it will be consuming a lot of energy. And this, here in this case, no energy will be utilized. Rather, you will be using hand and then doing a, it is good for exercise, physical exercise. So, what is hand spinning? That is the thing which will see that. It is basically a process of converting the cotton into yarn. And of course, two devices are used. One of them is drop spindle, which we call it takli, and other is the spinning wheel, what we call it charkha. This drop spindle, as you might have seen earlier also, that is, this is the fiber bunch or the cotton, you can call it as a punin, that is going through this groove, and then it is having a leader string, and this is a shaft, and this is the hoor which will be, can rotate. And this is a one typical case one can think of, local people might be using, made out of wood. And this is the drop spindle. And spinning wheel, which is the improved version of this spindle, drop spindle or takli, was invented around maybe something 500 CE. If you look at, this is the spinning wheel, and which I have shown here, and this also known as the charkha. If you look at, this is the wheel components having wheel, and this is, there is a spindle which is not shown here, and this wheel and the spindle is basically placed on this wheel stand, and there is, of course, nowadays a lot of pulleys are being used in this place also to improve its performance. During this spinning process, the fiber is to be held, generally the left hand, if you are a right hand person. But if it is a left handed person, it will be other way around. And the wheel is turned slowly with the right hand, this bigger wheel, which will be basically helpful in making this spindle to move properly so that you can twist it. And holding this fiber by this lady in this hand, whatever I have shown in this figure, is very important, particularly for maintaining certain angle, such that it will provide the strength to the yarn. It cannot be 90 degree, it is having certain slanted angle, which I will show you in the next video. And the drawn fibers are held at some angle to the spindle, as I told, not vertically. And so that in there, each slide off at the end of spindle and twist is added, that means more twisted will be added with this. And then when it will, hand will be moved towards this, then that means this wheel will rotate and it will be wounded on the spindle itself. That means you will be collecting the thread which will be made out of this fiber bunch, or you call punis. If you look at the charkha, is very old, and in 2015 that government of India actually produced to stamp, which is having the Mahatma Gandhi pictures. And Mahatma Gandhi wrote in Young India, 13 October 1921, the call of the spinning wheel is the noblest of all, because it is the call of love, and love is Swaraj. So, at that time he was trying to get Swaraj and also become independent country. But unfortunately, we have not achieved Swaraj till now. We are depending on the other countries too much at this moment of time, and we need to follow Mahatma Gandhi. According to him, the charkha represents Swadeshi, that means you will be doing all the things from our own country, self-sufficiency, and at the same time interdependency, because today people want to be independent. I always tell to my young friends like you that independent is not possible. You will have to depend. But what is important is the interdependence. That means you will have to appreciate others' work also. And why, according to him, wheel is the center of cotton of grower, weavers and users. So, therefore, it is very important. Let us now look at like types of charkhas or the spinning wheels. And there are, of course, I have noted down four, but there might be several others also. One is Bardoli charkha. And this charkha, which I have shown, is a stamp again, Bardoli charkha. And this is the actual model one can think of. That is, if you look at this, act like a, you know, pulley system, and this is the bigger pulley and this is a smaller pulley. And there is also the improved version, and this is the pulleys. As I told, there are more number of pulleys are being placed here. This is the, so that you can improve its performance. And this might be, they might have started from a place, Bardoli, this movement for popularizing the charkha and other things during the pre-independence time as a historical thing. That might be it is Bardoli. And there is also, you can say, it is on the ground you can keep and then keep that charkha. There is a tabletop charkha which is called peti. Peti means is a box you can keep in a box also and carry with you. It is very easy to carry. This is also known as tabletop. On the table itself you can put and do that work. And beside this there is a amber charkha which was being used basically in this place, in this photo, by the Rajendra Prasad, who was the first president of independent India. And this is a mechanized one. There might be, here you can have one spindle, in this case one spindle here, but here there are more than one. It can be two, it can be four. And at the time it was being designed and then fabricated, and it is far superior than the hand one. The yield of this yarn making is much higher as compared to the traditional charkha. And in current time, of course, there is a e-charkha. People are talking about it. And in this case, this is, according to me, it is an improved version of the amber chakra. The two spindle I have shown. It can be four spindle, it can be six spindle, even till eight people have made it. Lot of gear and arrangements are there, which I am not showing you. And beside this, there is also another improvement in the local level occur, like they will be using these wheels of the cycle and then do that. And this also the bamboo, like, you know, still, you know, local people, they do design the thing, which we call indigenous design, and they improve over the traditional one. So, therefore, these are the kinds of things what you can think of. There might be several other varieties which I have not really collected it and also looked at them, but you may look at it, and then if you come across something more than this, you can let me know. So let us now look at how does a charkha work.
Charkha apne aap mein hi entertainment ka manovinod ka sabse sundar aur sabse prabhavshali sadhan hai. Mera naam Dr. Sita Bimbro hai aur meri umr is samay 75 varsh hai. मैं उस समय 9-10 वर्ष की थी. गांधी जी का ऐसा प्रभाव था कि घर घर चरखे चलाए जाते थे और चरखे के गीत गाते थे कि चरखा चला चला के लेंगे स्वराज लेंगे. हर बुधवार को 3 से 5 कक्षा होती है चरखे की गांधी भवन में, और संख्या दिन प्रतिदिन बढ़ती चली जा रही है. मैं उनको स्टूडेंट्स नहीं कहती, मैं उनको यही कहती हूँ जो मेरे पास है मैं आपको सिखा रही हूँ, जो आपके पास है आप मुझे देंगे. हर बच्चे के पास ज्ञान है और केवल उसको रास्ता चाहिए. बच्चों को जब मैं चरखा सिखाती हूँ, उनके चेहरे पर रौनक देखती हूँ, तो मुझे बहुत खुशी होती है.
Most thing I learned was the peace of mind and the concentration. While spinning charkha, you have to concentrate a lot. With just because of the didi over here, we are also learning the peace of mind and how to keep calm I was a person who was very short-tempered before I joined the course. And after joining, I started with interactive sessions with Didi. I started to be calm down and be more active. This hobby is not that you are spinning charkha to earn money or anything. It's mainly based on the concentration, the sense of self-dependence this will give to you. And the most precisely, the simplicity this will provide to your life, which is most worthy thing in the current age.
बेसिकली आप जब चरखा चलाएंगे ना आपको समझ में आती है और चीज़ आप मतलब उसी को चलाते चलाते ना खो जाते ना कि आपका माइंड कहीं जाता ही नहीं है, आंखें बस चरखे पे होती है, हाथ घूम रहा होता है और बस हम लगे होते हैं उसे चलाने में, हम कुछ इधर उधर नहीं सुनते, जाता ही नहीं, अपने आप ही ध्यान नहीं जाता नेचुरली। तीन चीज़ मैम ने कहा था कि हमेशा अपने जीवन में साथ लेके चलना, पहली बात तो चरखे से जुड़े रहना और दूसरी बात खादी पहनना और सिंपल तरीके से अपना जीवन बिताना। तो मैं चाहूँगी कि मैं उसे फॉलो करूँ जितना कर पाऊँ।
सो इफ यू लुक एट यू कैन लर्न फ्रॉम दिस वीडियो दैट चरखा इज़ वेरी इम्पोर्टेंट फॉर प्रोड्यूसिंग द यार्न बट एट द सेम टाइम इट एनहांसेस द कंसंट्रेशन लेवल एंड ऑल्सो द पीस ऑफ माइंड। If you look at in modern days when digitization is going on, you can think of digital India, we are facing a lot of problem among the young people and also maybe the later on with the old people of concentration or the middle-aged people, concentration. This problem can be solved by using the charkha for spinning purposes. And it can also be utilized for getting a peace of mind. Let us start this discussion about modern e-charkha, which is basically improved version of amber charkha. And as I had showed you earlier, this is having a lot of gear mechanisms are there and which are quite complex in nature for designing and developing. And this is a two-spool e-charkha and various components, it will be having basically spinning units, which may be of single one or 2-1 or 4-1 or 8-spindle, maximum 8-spindle can be accommodated in this e-charkha. And it is having a unit, lighting unit, which is made of basically LED bulb. And it is having also a transistor radio, normal AM, FM tuner kind of things, where you can really listen to the songs and then programs. And it is also consists of a generator and battery, because you need electricity for running this LED bulb and the AM or FM tuners. So if you look at benefits of using only two spindle charkha is that you will get enormous if you just spin it for 2 hours and you can manage to produce yarn of length of 2.4 kilometers, and it can provide also light output or backup for 7.5 hours, of course, for a single bulb maybe. And spinning of this two spindle e-charkha for 25 days, less than a month, will produce yarn sufficient for a single bedsheet, bath towel and a shirt. So, if you look at, if you just spend 2 hours and for 25 days, you can manage to get yarn enough to do and meet your need. And one can also listen to the what you call programs on radio, and it will also make your body and mind fit and energetic. If you look at it can be utilized very much in the rural area where electricity has not gone, but they will also use electricity to some extent. So, it is a very good part and is improvised version. What I was trying to advocate basically to improvise our technology in the modern context, not copy the old technology and use it here today, which cannot be. So, that our people can get and then they can keep the ethos that living eco-friendly. So, let us look at the bobbin winding, which is a very important thing for the cotton making, because the yarn in the hang form is to be wound onto a bobbins in this process. Let me show you a picture over here. And this is basically the yank, if you look at, and this is your bobbin, which will be wounded properly. And this is the first step, basically transforming the yarn from the hank form to the linear form, which will be utilized for basically making warps and wafts kind of things. This, of course, the yarn or the hank yarn can be dyed before and also, and it can be put into the bobbins with the help of charkhas, which will be much easier to do that. And typically 19 to 20 bobbins are required to for a 5 sari warps length of 34 meters. If you look at in a sari, lot of threads or the ends are being utilized, and which has to be properly managed and with the help of winding over the bobbin. So, weaving is basically followed after the spinning process. The spinning has to be done first, and it is basically interlacement of warp. Warp is a thread running longitudinally in the loom, and if you look at this one, this is your warp. This is basically the warp, you can say, and this is your weft, the blue color one, and which is perpendicular to the warp thread and are to be knitted properly so that you will get a cloth. Basically, if you look at the warp and weft, warp we call tana in Hindi, and weft is the bana, tana bana. In other languages it will be different also, but generally we use that. And this has to be done in the hand. So therefore, we call it as basically hand loom. Warping is a process, like because this is the very important one, that this is the lengthwise threads which has to be arranged properly. Generally in the street or a very open space, it has to be done, and it is a very tedious and work which to be done by the hand. Of course, nowadays there is a lot of mechanized way of doing it, but we always emphasize earlier days, even today also in hand loom, to be made by hand. And this is the set of base lengthwise end that runs along the length of the fabric. This where is the length of the fabrics kind of thing, and through which this weft has to be passing through. And that is the basic design of any fabrics. This is the simplest one. Of course, nowadays with the help of machine, very complex fabric design has been developed. So, with this, I will stop over here, and then in the next lecture, we will be looking at basically the kinds of looms and how, what are the various parts of it and how it functions, and we will see in the next lecture. Thank you very much.